So let's just start with the very basic. So what are neuroendocrine tumors? What are NETs? So NETs are malignancies, essentially cancers, that can arise almost anywhere in the human body. And they are thought to arise from cells of the diffuse endocrine system, and most commonly occur in the small intestines, lungs, pancreas, and the rectum, but they can be seen anywhere else. Extremely heterogeneous group of tumors. These can be very slowly growing indolent tumors. They can present in a variety of ways, and that is one of the parts that makes it so difficult. And then they are fairly uncommon, too. So let's see if we can move this here. So the behavior of the NETs, it varies greatly from one NET to another. So it's not like you can easily predict how they will do. They can be among the slowest growing as well as the fastest growing human cancers. And what determines their growth and the aggressiveness is the grade and the differentiation. I'm going to spend a little bit of time on that, because that's something that you may have heard at your clinic visits or when you're reading about this. People are talking about grade and differentiation. And it all sounds a little bit confusing, so let me try to explain that to you. There we go. So what is grade and differentiation? Tumor grade is really a system to predict how fast these tumors will grow and spread. And there's a number of ways we can do that. We can count how many cells are actively dividing, or we can just stain the active cells with a stain called Ki-67 or MIB1. And this stain sticks to the cells that are growing or dividing and doesn't stick to those that are resting. So more dividing cells, more aggressive cancer. And this grade will really predict the outcomes. How fast will this cancer grow? How will it respond to therapy? And it can even predict how long a person will live. So this is how it's done. So we have a piece of tissue, a slice of tissue, and then we slap on this stain called Ki-67, and then we count the number of cells positive. So on the right-hand side, you see a grade 1 tumor. So all of these blue cells are just resting cells. You see a few brownish dots there. So this would be a grade 1 tumor. Most of the cells are in a resting state. Very few of them are actively dividing. On the other hand, on the right-hand side there, you have a grade 3 tumor. See, almost all of the cells are brown. So these are all like actively replicating growing cells. So what is tumor differentiation, though? So the tumor differentiation has more to do about how the tumor cells look. Do they look quiet, well-behaved, or do they look angry? How much do they look like the cancer that the organ they really started in? And I put this up there, so with the sloth there on the left-hand side and the bachelor on the right-hand side. So you just, the pathologist, an experienced pathologist, can look at this and just look at the slides and tell immediately if this is like an aggressively behaving cancer or not. So we don't always need the grade, but the grade and the differentiation are two different things, and they supplement each other. So I think we always need to do both, and there's a lot more interest in doing both now. So all poorly differentiated tumors are high grade. Not all high grade tumors are poorly differentiated. This is incredibly important and has become even more important in recent years. We can hopefully discuss this some here offline, but it's just a little too convoluted and complicated to go into in the talk. So stage. So I was trying to come up with one slide to explain stage. So stage is really the other main determinant of prognosis. That is really how extensive is the cancer. So stage one tumor is localized, a very small tumor in the organ it started in. A stage four tumor is a tumor that has metastasized to other organs, such as the liver or the lungs or the bones. Stage three tumors typically are tumors that have metastasized to lymph nodes. So how common are the neuroendocrine tumors? So they are not very common. They are actually common in terms of how many patients are out there with neuroendocrine tumors. We don't have a ton of new diagnoses per year, but just because patients with neuroendocrine tumors live long compared to many other cancers, the number of patients with neuroendocrine tumors at any given time is fairly high. So what I wanted to show you with that graph there, if you look at the top line, the blue line, that's the number of all cancers since 1971, so new cancers in the U.S. And you can see that it hasn't really changed that much. It's sort of hovering around the same level there, went up a little bit in the late 80s and early 90s, and now the number of new cancers in the U.S. is actually coming down, partly due to colon cancer screening and other screening methods. If you look at the orange line, that's the number of new neuroendocrine tumors. That number just keeps going up, up, up. And mostly notable in lung neuroendocrine tumors and pancreatic neuroendocrine tumors, partly I think because of we're doing so many scans where we didn't do before. So a lot of these are incidental. So these are patients who come in, have a scan for a kidney stone, and we find a pancreatic neuroendocrine tumor, which might have been there for years and could have been there for another 10 years without anyone knowing. But just because we're doing so many more scans, we're picking up so many more tumors. So what are the symptoms of neuroendocrine tumors? So this is a tough one because they can really present in such a variety of ways. So I tried to split this into tumors or symptoms caused by the tumor itself and the symptoms caused by stuff that the tumor makes. So for symptoms from the tumor itself could be obstructive symptoms, so let's say cramping abdominal pain because something is blocking a bowel, jaundice because something is blocking a bile duct, cough, or recurrent pneumonia because something is blocking a bronchial tube. You these tumors can bleed, you can cough up blood, or you can see blood in your stools if there's a rectal neuroendocrine tumor. These tumors can cause pain, oftentimes pains from liver metastases or bone metastases, or there can be a lump, something that you can actually feel. And then there can be non-specific symptoms, which are actually very common, like weight loss and just not feeling well. And then there can be symptoms from the stuff that the tumor makes, and I just keep having problems with my clicker. And so carcinoid syndrome, so these are almost always from small bowel neuroendocrine tumors, usually flushing, made worse by alcohol, exercise, emotional upset. Diarrhea obviously is a dominant symptom. Carcinoid heart disease is something that we see fairly frequently now. Carcinoid crisis is something many of you have heard of. Fortunately, it's actually very rare. And I can go easily 2-3 years with seeing no carcinoid syndrome, and I see a lot of carcinoid patients every year. So hormonal symptoms, these are symptoms caused by chemicals or hormones that the tumors are making. Those are mostly pancreatic neuroendocrine tumors, not always. So insulinoma, these are tumors that make insulin. They can drop your blood sugar, make you really dizzy and disoriented. Gastrinoma is a tumor that makes a hormone called gastrin that increases the stomach acids that can really burn a hole in the stomach, cause perforations of the stomach, severe diarrhea, reflux. And then the others are much, much less common. So this is a picture I got from the Canadian Medical Journal almost 10 years ago. This is probably the best picture I've found of a carcinoid flush. A lot of the textbook pictures are just very exaggerated. This one is a fairly typical carcinoid flush, sort of pink flush, sometimes made worse by drinking alcohol with exercise. Even if you push on the liver, if there's a large liver, you can actually make that worse. And sometimes if it's been long-standing, it takes on this sort of purple color, and you can see that there are very prominent little capillaries under the skin. So this would be a typical flushing patient with carcinoid. But with modern therapy, this flushing is usually not so much of a problem. So how do we diagnose the neuroendocrine tumors? I want to emphasize that this is a team effort. This is not one person that can really do this all. We need a team of skilled people to do it. So the crucial part is the pathologist. And so we have to have an experienced pathologist because these are tough tumors to read. They are very, very commonly misread by pathologists who don't see a lot of neuroendocrine tumors. I see a number, handful of patients every year who come in to Mayo with a neuroendocrine tumor that is misdiagnosed. Sometimes it's not a neuroendocrine tumor. Sometimes it's a high-grade tumor. Sometimes it's a low-grade tumor that was read as a high-grade tumor and the patient got very aggressive chemotherapy they may or may not have needed. And so you really need the pathologist. And a lot of times, for example, at Mayo, there's one pathology to look at it, looks at it, and there are maybe one or two others that have a second look. So just because these are really tough. And then we need radiology. I think we hear some more from radiology here in a little bit, and nuclear medicine. And again, experience really matters. You need someone who does this day in, day out. And then we need other specialties, gastroenterology. Someone has to get us the tissue samples, surgery, clinical chemistry, pulmonary medicine, and the list goes on and on. So tumor markers, I know this may come up. So tumor markers have, I would say, somewhat limited utility in the management of most patients with neuroendocrine tumors. So there are multiple tumor markers out there. I find myself using less and less of them as the years go by. They can be useful for certain patients and with functional tumors, and they are never enough to make a diagnosis, and there's really not a perfect marker out there. So tumor imaging, I'm going to skip over this because I think we have a talk on that next. So why do we need better medical therapy? So I was going to try to illustrate that with one picture. This is a man I saw a few months ago. He came in with a liver tumor, and that's all we knew. We thought there was a liver tumor there. He had a gallium-68 dotatate scan, and this is the scan, and you can see all of those white spots. These are bone, lymph node, and skin metastases. So we had thought about liver surgery, and now with all of these other metastases out there, we decided liver surgery was not in his best interest, and we went with drug therapy. Fortunately, we have a lot of treatments. Does everyone need to be treated? No. So there is patients with low volume disease, with few tumors, with few symptoms, they can actually be observed without therapy. That is perfectly appropriate for some patients with neuroendocrine tumors. And something I frequently use. This scan is someone I saw when I was in Arizona. He was found to have a neuroendocrine tumor in the liver. We decided not to treat it. It wasn't really feasible for him. He lived out in the country in New Mexico. And then we followed him for 3 years, and the scans never changed. He never took a single shot of anything. And this was a biopsy-proven neuroendocrine tumor. So moving on, so we're treatment considerations here. So why do we treat patients with neuroendocrine tumors? We treat to relieve symptoms from carcinoid syndrome, from bulky tumors, and from functional pancreatic neuroendocrine tumors, and we treat patients to prolong life. But you also have to be very careful that some of these treatments can be toxic, and prolonging life at the cost of severe side effects may, for some people, not be worth it. They were looking at a few months. So you have to be very honest with your patients about the benefits of the treatments and the toxicities. So don't forget that each patient is unique and one size does not fit all. That's why I think we need neuroendocrine tumor centers where people really devote themselves to treating neuroendocrine tumors. As for the symptoms, we have somatostatin analogs, other drugs for diarrhea, telitrostat, everolimus for hypoglycemia and insulinoma, chemotherapy, PRRT now, of course, and not all symptom treatments are drugs. We will hear much more about liver embolization and surgery as a part of treating symptoms. So small bowel NETs, so this is how we treat them today. Somatostatin analogs, octreotide or lanreotide are the options most commonly used and available to us. Tumors don't generally shrink much, but we can stabilize the tumor so they don't grow. Incredibly well tolerated, very effective in controlling symptoms. We have everolimus or Afinitor, which is modestly effective, certainly works for a lot of patients. We don't have a lot of data on how well it controls symptoms. Chemotherapy for small bowel tumors generally does not work. So there are exceptions, but generally very ineffective. Interferon alpha has been out there for a long time, has a lot of side effects, and we generally don't use it. So pancreatic neuroendocrine tumors, octreotide or lanreotide, they're really reasonable as first-line therapy, initial therapy. Chemotherapy can be used to treat very bulky, painful tumors. And then we have a lot of targeted treatments, everolimus, sunitinib, and then obviously PRRT. So CAPTEM is very effective. So this is a patient I saw. This capecitabine temozolomide had very large liver metastases. On the left-hand side, you can see those gray areas in the liver. These were liver tumors. With treatment, they shrunk down to almost nothing. So what's on the horizon? Let's spend one slide on that here. So I think we're at the end of the road with the classic chemotherapy. I don't think we're going to get a new chemotherapy drug that works. Future is all about the immunotherapy, targeted therapy, combinations of targeted and immunotherapy, and obviously all of the drugs that we don't know about even, which the NET Research Foundation will help us discover in the coming years. So several attractive targets, blood vessel formation, and targeting little sort of cogs in the machinery of the tumor growth, your own immune system even. And so just to summarize, so it's how do we sequence therapy? What should we start with? what we do next when the tumors are progressing on the therapy and how do we sort of go about doing that. I'm going to skip over this wordy slide there and just go right into this. So this is the old sequence for systemic therapy for small bowel neuroendocrine tumors. We started with somatostatin analogs, octreotide and lanreotide, then everolimus, and then, so let me see if the, I am just not really not skilled at this, am I? So, do they really let me prescribe chemotherapy? we have other treatments, and then this is the old one, and then PRT. So now we're into the new era of current sequence of therapy, somatostatin analogs. PRT is now a very reasonable second-line therapy for those with metastatic disease. Everolimus still has a solid place in the treatment of patients with small bowel neuroendocrine tumors, and then others, including clinical trials. And we hear about the liver-directed therapy here in a moment. So, and then for pancreatic neuroendocrine tumors, so with no or minimal symptoms, somatostatin analogs are very reasonable. PRT, sunitinib, or everolimus, we have three options. So more options are always good. But the problem is, how do we sequence them? What do we pick first? And so everolimus, sunitinib, PRT, CAPTEM, others. If there are hormonal symptoms, somatostatin analogs, CAPTEM, chemotherapy, everolimus. So just saying that things have changed the last year, if their tumors are really bulky, painful, chemotherapy, PRT, other chemotherapies like FOLFOX and CAPOX, and then everolimus, sunitinib, or somatostatin analogs. So I think that brings me to the end of the talk here. And